السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل هو الله أحد، الله الصمد، لم يلد ولم يولد، ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله ثم أما بعد. Once again, for all of you that are watching and listening, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We are beginning our study of Surah Al-Ikhlas. Surah Al-Ikhlas is the surah that follows in the Mus'haf, Surah Lahab, that we completed last time. And in the introduction of this surah, a few things need to be said. First and foremost, what connects this surah to the one that comes before it is even the style of the surah, the saj'a of the Qur'an. What I mean by that is the syllables with which words end. There's a certain rhythmic pattern. So we had tabbat yada abi lahabin wa tab ma aghna anhu maluhu wa ma kasab sayasla naran dhata lahab. You see that pattern? And then the final syllable was fi jidiha hablum min masad. Then here qul huwa allahu ahad, allahu samad, lam yalid wa lam yulad. So the rhyme pattern actually continues. From a stylistic point of view also, there's this cohesion and there's continuity. Additionally, of course, there are several things that connect this surah to the last. In the previous surah, there was a departure from what Allah Azza wa Jalla said before. He dealt with the enemy of Islam exclusively. You know, when he dealt with the kafirun, he told the messenger, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ. He told the messenger to talk to them. When it came to Abu Lahab, the messenger wasn't even involved. He didn't even tell the messenger alayhi salatu wasalam to address Abu Lahab. He didn't say قُلْ تَبَّتْ يَدَا أَبِي لَهَبٍ. No. Allah will deal with Abu Lahab directly himself. It is as though Allah Azza wa Jalla took on himself the offense against the messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. Now, we learned from the historical context that Abu Lahab is one of the individuals that preoccupied and concerned the messenger a lot, alayhi salatu wasalam, and it's not easy to forget about him because he lives next door. And he's constantly making trouble and nuisance. So it's not something, you know, there's a troublemaker you see on the battlefield and you won't worry about him the next time you see him on the battlefield. Until then, there's no problem. That's not the case with Abu Lahab. But since in the previous surah, Allah Azza wa Jal has dealt comprehensively and conclusively with Abu Lahab, now the messenger is told to change his focus. Not worry about it anymore, because that problem is not for you to solve, Allah has already solved it. So what should you be worried about? You should be worried about two things. The concern for yourself, the tawheed of Allah, and the concern that you should be teaching it to others, the tawheed of Allah. Stay focused on target and remain focused on the goal itself, which is teaching the people Allahu Ahad, Hu Allahu Ahad. So Allah tells His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the surah, قُلْ هُوَ Allahu Ahad. It's going back on the agenda with which the seerah of the Messenger begins sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Another very interesting comment that we're going to expand upon when we inshallah ta'ala get to Surah An-Nas. But I'll give you some hint to it now. You know, in the Fatiha, in the introduction of the Qur'an, the first ayah of Fatiha, when Allah Azza wa Jalla says, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. There are two parts of it. He introduces himself as Allah, Alhamdulillah, and then he describes himself as Rabbil Alameen. At the end of the Qur'an, we find these two things. Surah Al-Ikhlas is the answer to the question, who is Allah? It's just about Allah. And about Rabb, there are two surahs. قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقْ and قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِ Rabbin Nas. They're both about that. So that what initiates in the Fatiha is even beautifully concluded at the end of the Mus'haf as well. So now that the attention of the Messenger has been directed towards this call of La ilaha illallah, the other thing that you may or may not recall, we talked about it a few weeks ago, what connects this surah to the previous is that if you look at the last seven surahs, they were all about the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They were all about the seerah. إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ was about the seerah. قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ was about the seerah. You know, Quraysh, Surah Quraysh was about the seerah. Every single one of those surahs had something to do with the life of the Messenger, عَلَيْهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, which concludes with Surah Lahab. Surah Lahab is pretty much the historical journey comes to an end. The victory is guaranteed. And Abu Lahab is served up. The worst enemy of the Messenger and of Allah has been destroyed. Now, when there's a conflict that goes on for a long time, people forget what they were fighting about. This conflict that is happening between the Messenger and the Quraysh, it's going on for a long time. So in a conflict, as soon as the victory is guaranteed, it is important you remember what is it that you were fighting about to begin with. What was the agenda of the conflict? What started this battle? It wasn't about land. It wasn't about control. It wasn't about territory. The only thing it was about was continuing and fulfilling the legacy of Ibrahim alayhi salam, which is what? Tawheed, ikhlas, sincerity. So we're coming back to the agenda itself in Surah Al-Ikhlas. So the other thing that, this is something more subtle but deserves a lot of attention. You know, in the Prophet ﷺ's sunnah, sometimes he would pray and he would combine two surahs in salah. Like he would make, for example, Surah Al-A'la and Ghashiyah, he would put them together in many of the sunnah prayers. Similarly, he would take two surahs that are together, like Al-Falaq and Al-Nas. He would take them together and recite them, one in one rak'ah, the other in the other rak'ah, things like that. And usually when he pairs surahs together, you find them paired together in the Mus'haf also. So you find them next to each other in the Qur'an, and you find the Messenger والسلام, reciting them one after the other in the prayer. Makes sense. So he pairs them in the salah, and Allah pairs them in the Mus'haf. But there's a unique sunnah of the Prophet والسلام. This is pretty much for every two sunnahs, the most recurring recitation of Qur'an, the two sunnahs of every fard prayer, even the two sunnahs of going at the haram, when you're making Umrah and Hajj, when you go to the Haram for the first time, the two rak'ah you make, there he would recite Surah Al-Kafirun and Surah Al-Ikhlas. So the first rak'ah Al-Kafirun, the next rak'ah Al-Ikhlas, right? So this is a unique sunnah because in this sunnah, the Messenger ﷺ is reciting one surah, then skipping a few, and then going to another surah. Surah Al-Kafirun and Surah Al-Ikhlas are not together. They're apart. After Kafirun came إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ. Then in the Mus'haf there's تَبَّتْ يَدَا أَبِي لَهَبْ. And then after that you have Surah Al-Ikhlas. So there's some unique connection that the Messenger himself makes in his prayers between Surah Al-Kafirun and Surah Al-Ikhlas. That should be that deserves attention. And it's interesting that from a literary point of view, that relationship becomes very, very obvious. And I'm going to try to highlight that relationship to you before we get into the surah itself. You see, when Allah Azza wa Jal, when we discuss Surah Al-Kafirun itself, at the end of Surah Al-Kafirun, it was clear that the Messenger has his deen, and that should never be confused with the deen of the kuffar. They are two very, very different things. Even though they are worshipping at the same house, the Kaaba, even though when they call on Allah, وَلَئِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ لَيَقُولُنَّ اللَّهِ. If you ask them who created the heavens and the earth, even they will say what? They will say Allah. The Messenger is calling to Allah. Even the mushrikun are calling to Allah. So it seems like, yeah, they have a lot in common. But Surah Al-Kafirun made it clear, no. These are two very different religions. There's no, you are kafir and I'm certainly not engaged in the worship and slavery of what you're engaged in the worship and slavery of. Now that distinction is made in Surah Al-Kafirun and explained further in إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ. That's the deen that will win. And which deen will lose? The deen of Abu Lahab. تَبَّتْ يَدَا أَبِي لَهَبْ. In other words, the central surah is Al-Kafirun. If you want to visualize a pyramid, at the top of the pyramid is Surah Al-Kafirun, and the two offshoots of it are إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ and تَبَّتْ يَدَا أَبِي لَهَبْ. Right? So that the two next surahs are a continuation or a corollary of that central discussion of Surah Al-Kafirun. Now the same thing happens with Surah Al-Ikhlas. Surah Al-Ikhlas is about Tawheed. Tawheed. And what are the two kinds of attacks that can corrupt a person's Tawheed? These are evil influences from the outside or from the inside. Where are these mentioned? The central position, that of Surah Al-Ikhlas. Then you have Surah Al-Falaq and you have Surah An-Nas. So you have one central surah and two corollary surahs, the same way you had that tri-surah connection before then. Now if you look at both central surahs, you find something else. You notice in Surah Al-Ikhlas, the word Allah is not mentioned. Not Ikhlas, Surah Al-Kafirun. قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لا أعبد ما تعبدون ولا أنتم عابدون ما أعبد ولا أنا عابد ما عبدتم ولا أنتم عابدون ما أعبد لكم دينكم واليدين. No mention of who? No mention of Allah. And even when the Messenger says I who I worship, he just says ما أعبد. He doesn't say Allah. ولا أنتم عابدون الله. He doesn't say Allah. He just says ما أعبد. Right? ولا أنا عابد ما عبدتم. But he doesn't mention Allah explicitly. So what it does, Surah Al-Kafirun, it creates a question. He keeps saying, مَا أَعْبُدُ مَا أَعْبُدُ. Twice it comes in Surah Al-Kafirun. What amazing an entity it is that I worship. He doesn't mention him by name. So what question is created? Well, who is it that you worship? That question is created. And where is that question answered? When that question is created in Surah Al-Kafirun, where is it comprehensively answered?
in Suratul Ikhlas. So the two are actually rhetorically very beautifully connected. Of course, the other thing that connects them, that is Adhar min Ash-Shams, is very obvious. That one begins with Qul, and after a couple of skips, this one also begins with Qul. These, they both begin in the same way. And of course, both of them, you know, the Sahaba would give these, the surahs that they loved a lot, and they would repeat a lot, they would give them a lot of nicknames. So Suratul Ikhlas has over 20 nicknames. And one of those nicknames is Al-Muqashqish. It's a strange word in Arabic, but that's one of the names they gave it. And Muqashqish means that which removes diseases. You know, they will say, for example, Taqshish al-Marid, the Arab would say. What that means is the patient, the disease is completely gone, no sign of it left. And that's what they called Suratul Ikhlas. Why? Because it removes the disease of shirk. By the way, of all those nicknames, Suratul Kafirun also was given the same nickname. The same nickname. Because what they thought of, what the Sahaba thought of when they thought of Suratul Ikhlas is the same thing they thought of when they thought of Suratul Kafirun. Why? Because both of them are talking about denying shirk. Both of them are against shirk. One from positive reinforcement, the other negative reinforcement. Suratul Kafirun is also about the Tawheed of Allah. La a'budu ma ta'budun. Lakum deenukum waliyadeen. Here also, this is also about Tawheed. So that also connects these two remarkable surahs together. Now, one of the few nicknames, we won't go through all 20 nicknames, but at least some of the titles that are given by the Sahaba to this beautiful surah, we should make sure we appreciate at least some of them. Here's one, Surah At-Tafrid. Tafrid, fard means individual. This one, the surah that makes sure that Allah is only always to be understood as one and never to be thought as anything more. Then Surah At-Tajreed, that which purges the concept of Allah from all false concepts, removes all misconceptions, misinformation about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in one shot. This is Surah At-Tajreed. Then the Sahaba would name it, of course, easiest one, this one you can appreciate too, Surah At-Tawheed. The one that unifies the attributes of Allah in one and expresses Allah as one and only. Surah Al-Ma'rifah, meaning if you don't know this surah, you don't really know who Allah is. Ma'rifah means to know someone, to be acquainted with someone. So this is the surah for one to be acquainted with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was also called Surah Al-Samad. Surah Al-Samad. Samad, of course, we'll discuss linguistically in more detail later on, but the surah which, and it's called this because this is the only place in Quran where this word is used, and it's used for Allah Azza wa Jal, and no derivative of this word from that root in verbal form and nominal form, it's not used anywhere else in the Quran. This is the only surah that has the word Samad in it. So another name of it, Surah Al-Samad. Surah Al-Asas, the surah of the essence, the core, the essence of something, the essential, the most basic core component. They would say this is the asas of the entire deen. This is the core of the mission of the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Then, of course, the name I gave you, Al-Muqashqasha, or Muqashqisha rather. And this is the one that purges disease, purges sickness, and you know, that which is supposed to, which causes the body harm, well, this causes the heart's harm. And the hearts have been cleansed now, and this disease has been removed. Another very beautiful and interesting comment about the word asas. Why the Sahaba would call this surah Suratul Asas. There's a hadith of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. أُسِّسَتْ أَسَّمَاوَاتُ السَّبْعُ وَالْأَرْضُونَ السَّبْعُ عَلَىٰ قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. The heavens and the earth are founded upon قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. The tawheed of Allah. And the way this hadith has been commented on by in sharh, what you find is that this, so long as there are people on the face of this earth that are declaring tawheed, Allah Azza wa Jal allows the heavens and the earth to continue and the heavens and the earth to exist. And when, you know, when people do shirk on this earth and they say Allah has taken a son, or they say things that are inappropriate about Allah, look at the wording of Allah Himself. تَكَادُ السَّمَاوَاتُ يَتَفَطَّرْنَ مِنْهُ وَتَنْشَقُّ الْأَرْضُ وَتَخِرُّ الْجِبَالُ SubhanAllah. It is almost, not exactly, but almost as though the sky would tear open and the earth would rip, crack open, and the mountains would collapse when people say Allah has taken a son. When people say that, that is about to happen. That is about to happen. So the Messenger says the only thing keeping things intact is what? قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. And when we don't say that, what happens? And now look at the signs of the last day. One of the signs, one of the things that happens before the last day comes, everybody who says La ilaha illallah, everybody who says Muhammadur Rasulullah, what happens to them? They're gone. The people of La ilaha illallah are gone before Allah Azza wa Jal brings about the collapse of the skies and the earth. right? So this is a very powerful concept and a very powerful surah, and it's central to our appreciation of this deen. And of course, this idea of had there only been shirk, this is mentioned in other places in Quran. For example, لَوْ كَانَ فِيهِمَا آلِهَا إِلَّا اللَّهِ لَفَسَدَتَا. Had there been any others to worship and obey other than Allah, then the heavens and the earth would have been corrupted and there would have been conflict between them. Because if you have multiple gods, look at any religion that has multiple gods, by the way. There's forms of Hinduism that have multiple gods. Greek mythology had multiple gods, right? When you have multiple gods, you know what the mythology includes? Gods fighting with each other. The god of love fighting the god of war, the father god fighting the son. You'll find this kind of mythology all the time. And this is only natural. When you have two people of equal power, when you have two nations of equal power, right? Two fighters, two warriors of equal power, two business people of equal power, two countries of equal power. What's inevitable? Clash, conflict. So Allah says if there were more than one ilah, there would be conflict in the heavens and the earth. Subhanallah. Then of course, this surah, one of its most beautiful names, also comes from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's called Suratul Nur, the surah of light. You know, in Surah An-Nur, Allah says, "Allahu nuru samawati wal ard." Here in this hadith, "Fahuwa al-munawwir lis-samawat wal ard," and Allah and His Tawheed is that which gives light to the heavens and the earth. "Was-suratu tunawwir qalbak," and this surah, it gives light to your heart. وَقَالَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامُ إِنَّ لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ نُورٌ وَنُورُ الْقُرْآنِ قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. Everything has light. For everything, there is a light, and the light of the Quran is قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. And this is a tremendous gift of Allah. You know, the Messenger of Allah, عليه الصلاة والسلام, he would say, for example, about Baqarah. لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ سَلَامٌ وَسَلَامُ الْقُرْآنِ الْبَقَرَةِ. For everything, there's a peak, and the peak of the Qur'an is Baqarah. But the light of the Qur'an is what? Is Suratul Ikhlas. You know why this is such an amazing gift? That every man, woman, and child can make a little bit of effort and memorize this surah with very little effort. And the power of the surah is so tremendous and so huge, and yet the lessons are so massive, and yet it takes you 20 minutes to memorize it. And it takes you very little effort to recurringly repeat it and say it over and over again. And so this will lead us, inshallah ta'ala, into, I haven't gotten into the historical context of the surah yet, which we'll do now, inshallah ta'ala, and then we'll get into how the sahaba loved this surah. How much in love they were with this surah. I mean, they loved the Quran, yes. But there was this something special about this surah when it comes to the companions of the Messenger, radiyallahu anhum ajma'in. Now there's a debate among certain classical mufassirun about the historical context in which this surah is revealed. Most call it Makki, but some legitimate scholars have also given many, many, many narrations in which this seems to be a Madani surah too. Now why is it called Makki? Because there were some, we already said the mushrikun, what word for God did they use? Even though they did shirk, what word for Allah did they use? They used the word Allah. And here in the Quran, Allah is using the same word for Himself. But when they think of Allah, they think of, you know, ideas they associate with Him are not appropriate. That's not what we want you to believe about Allah. So when the Messenger ﷺ would describe and talk about Allah, they would say, well, we don't get it. We believe in Allah too. So they would say, صِفْ لَنَا رَبَّكْ. Give me attributes of your, give us attributes of your master. Describe him to us. Who is this Lord of yours? Give us some descriptions. You know, a min dhahab, a min fidda. Is he made of gold? Is he made of silver? You know, and why would they say that? Because this is precious to them, right? And their gods are made of these kinds of precious metals and marble and things like that. So they say, well, give us some quality. And they're looking for physical attributes. Then they would say, ansibhu, because in the Arabs, you know, the lineage is very important. So they would say, what's his lineage? You know, what's his lineage? Actually, somebody, in one narration, somebody came, this mushrik came to the Messenger ﷺ and said, well, you know, everything was created by Allah. فَمَنْ خَلَقَ اللَّهُ Who created Allah then? The Messenger was furious. He was very furious. So the narration goes that Jibreel ﷺ calmed the Messenger down and gave him this surah. Jibreel calmed him down and gave him this surah. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. Right? And this is actually attributed to a similar narration is given to a Yahudi, a Jew, a member of the Jewish community in the Madani era of the Prophet's life. So that's why some people say it's Madani. Others say, of course, this Sif lana rabbak, attribute your Lord, give us descriptions of him. Several of these narrations are Makki. So how do we combine both? Some scholars made the effort to combine both by saying perhaps it was revealed twice, which of course is not taken by the majority. The majority has taken the opinion that both those narrations are correct and sound. And the way to understand them is, you know, sometimes a surah would be, the messenger would recite a surah, and this is a surah that the people of Mecca, the Sahaba in Mecca, have heard many, many, many times. But when he's come to Medina, it's not necessary that all the Sahaba have heard all of the Qur'an yet. So when they would hear that same surah being used as an answer to a question, they would think that that surah came down at that immediate time. But that's not necessarily the case. It is that this surah answers this question just like it answered that question. And this feeling, actually, even in a famous narration, you know the ayah from Surah Ali Imran, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُولُ. You know, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is nothing but a messenger. Messengers came before him also. This ayah was recited by Abu Bakr as-Siddiq upon the passing of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when Umar bin al-Khattab just had a psychological meltdown. He said, anybody who says the messenger has passed away, I'm going to take his head off. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq comes and he recites this ayah. Muhammad is nothing but a messenger. Messengers came before him too. Afa immata, if he was to die, aw qutila, or he was killed, in qalabtum ala aqabikum, are you going to turn back on your heels? So when Umar bin al-Khattab hears this ayah, what does he say? It is as though I heard this for the first time. I felt like this surah just came down. It was just revealed. Right? Even though it's been revealed before, it addresses his problem at that time. So that's how we reconcile the narrations of the Makki context and both the Madani concept context. Now talking about the love of this surah. This is narrated Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. Anna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, ba'atha rajulan ala Syria. فكان يقرأ سريا رادر فكان يقرأ لأصحابه في صلاتهم فيختم بقل هو الله أحد فلما رجعوا. What happens is he was on a military expedition. Some companions he sent were on a military expedition, and the guy in charge of them, the Sahabi in charge of them, every single salah he would lead, he would recite something from Quran, but before he would go to ruku' he would recite Surah Al-Ikhlas every rak'ah. Right, so the Sahaba didn't say anything because that's the guy in charge. But when they came back, they mentioned it. So ذكروا ذلك لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. They mentioned this to the messenger. فقال سلوه لأي شيء يصنع ذلك. Ask him, the messenger says, why did he do this? What made him do that? فسألوه. So they asked him. فقال لأنها صفة الرحمن. Because this is the attribute, this surah is the proper attributing of Ar-Rahman, the Most Merciful. فَأَنَا أُحِبُّ أَنْ أَقْرَأَ بِهَا. So I love to recite with it. I can't let go of it. I love reciting this surah. So the messenger says, فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَمْ أَخْبِرُوهُ أَنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى يُحِبُّهُ. Let him know that Allah himself loves him. That it is Allah who loves him back. So he loves Surah Al-Ikhlas. And loving Surah Al-Ikhlas can only mean one thing. It can only mean the love of Allah. Right, you know, one of the Mufassir al-Shawkani went on to comment the show of love and admiration that is found for the messenger in Surah Al-Kawthar is found for Allah in Surah Al-Ikhlas. The love for the messenger ﷺ is which surah? Al-Kawthar. And the love and admiration and sincerity to Allah in Al-Ikhlas. So when this man, this sahabi, loves to recite Surah Al-Ikhlas, what does it illustrate? Love of Allah. And if you love Allah, Allah loves you back. Allah Azza wa Jalla loves you back. So the messenger says to him, inform him that Allah loves him. Now he used to recite it at the end of every rak'ah. Now here's another narration by Anas radiallahu anhu. كان رجل من الأنصار يأمهم في مسجد قباء فكان كلما افتتح سورة يقرأ بها لهم في الصلاة مما يقرأ به افتتح به قل هو الله أحد. There was a man from the Ansar. He used to lead salah in Masjid Quba, and every time he would start a rak'ah, after finishing Fatiha, before he would recite anything else from Quran, he would recite قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٍ. He wouldn't go anywhere else but قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٍ first. So the other Sahabi is reciting it at the end, and this one's going even further and reciting it in the beginning. حَتَّى يَفْرُغُ مِنْهَا ثُمَّ كَانَ يَقْرُؤُ سُورَةٌ أُخْرَى. And then he would finish, then he would recite another one with it, سُورَةٌ أُخْرَى مَعَهَا. وَكَانَ يَصْنَعُ ذَلِكَ فِي كُلِّ رَكْعَةٍ. And he would do this in every single rak'ah. فَكَلَّمَهُ أَصْحَابُهُ فَقَالُوا. So the Sahaba spoke to him and they said, why do you do this? إِنَّكَ تَفْتَتِحُ بِهَذِهِ السُّورَةِ ثُمَّ لَا تَرَى أَنَّهَا تُجْزِئُكْ حَتَّى تَقْرَأَ بِالْأُخْرَى. And we don't see that you never ever stop doing it. You read it and then you recite something else. So you know, we don't think that's appropriate. فَإِمَّا أَن تَقْرَأَ بِهَا. Either you just read this one. وَإِمَّا أَن تَدَّعَهَا rather. وَتَقْرَأَ بِأُخْرَى. Or you leave it and recite something else. So they said, either you just read Ikhlas or you read something else. Don't keep combining. We don't think it's appropriate. He says, مَا أَنَا بِتَارِكِهَا. I'm not going to leave it.
إن أحببتم أن أؤمكم بذلك ففعلت.
If you want me to lead salah, then that's what I'm going to do. That's what he tells them.
وإن كرهتم تركتكم.
And if you want, then I'm going to leave all of you. If you don't like it, then I'm not leading salat anymore. Okay.
وَكَانُوا يَرَوْنَ أَنَّهُ مِنْ أَفْضَلِهِمْ. And they used to see that he was definitely the best of them.
He was the most righteous of them. And he was obviously appointed by the Messenger, صلى الله عليه وسلم, so they couldn't just oust him like that.
وَكَرِهُوا أَنْ يَأُمُّهُمْ غَيْرَهُ.
And they would also not like that somebody else would lead the salah. فَلَمَّا أَتَاهُمُ النَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. So they came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
أخبروه. They told him what had occurred. فقال يا فلان مما يمنعك أن تفعل مما ما يأمر به أصحابك.
So what keeps you from doing what your companions are telling you? What's so hard about that for you?
And why do you commit yourself على لزوم هذه السورة في كل ركعة.
Why do you commit yourself in every single rak'ah to this surah?
فَقَالَ إِنِّي أُحِبُّهَا.
He also says, I love it. No doubt about it, I love this surah. His only explanation, he has to keep reciting it. He says,
حُبُّكَ إِيَّهِ. Your love for it, أَدْخَلَكَ الْجَنَّةِ.
Will get you into Jannah. The Messenger tells him, your love for this surah will enter you into Jannah. And I felt it's important that we go through these few narrations of the importance and the value that the Sahaba gave to this surah, and then how the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam appreciated their seriousness about this surah. Then this famous hadith, probably some narration of it, or if not the narration, you probably know the lesson, the message that comes out of it. You've heard it before. This is narrated Abu Darda. أَيُعْجِزُ أَحَدُكُمْ أَنْ يَقْرَأَ فِي لَيْلَةٍ ثُلُثَ الْقُرْآنِ.
Is it very difficult for any of you to recite the entire one-third of the entire Qur'an in one night?
قَالُوا وَكَيْفْ يُقْرَأْ ثُلُثُ الْقُرْآنِ.
How can a third of the Qur'an be recited in one night?
قَالَ قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ تَعْدِلْ ثُلُثَ الْقُرْآنِ.
He said that قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ equates a third of the Qur'an. This is in Sahih Muslim. So the Messenger himself has given this surah a value of a third of the Qur'an. There's a lot of commentary, why a third? Why a third of the Qur'an? It is, you know, and most of the, I'll give you the gist of it. The gist of it is, a third of the Qur'an deals with the attributes of Allah, who Allah is, imaniyat, the essence of what this deen is supposed to be in terms of iman. And Surah Al-Ikhlas is the most comprehensive summary of it. If you know nothing else from Qur'an about Tawheed, if you know Ikhlas, you're okay. You're okay. You won't fall into shirk. If you know enough, you know, and so this is gem that Allah gave us, that you don't have to do a PhD in Aqeedah to not fall into shirk. You can just really well understand Surah Al-Ikhlas. It's a gift of Allah Azza wa Jal to this ummah, a third of Qur'an. Now, you know, there are a lot of academic issues in this surah, and I'm going to skip a lot of them, but I do want to tell you about one thing that is important. The word Allah. The word Allah. We haven't had a comprehensive discussion about this word. Of course, it's come before, but this is a surah about the word, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ. So we have to have a little bit of a conversation about it. In the Arabic language, there's such a thing called ishtiqaq. Ishtiqaq means that a word is based on another word. It came from somewhere else. Like, you know, you may have heard the word alim, alim, right? It has, it's mushtaq, it's derived from what word? Ilm, knowledge. Right? So you have a word, it's derived from another word. It has origins or roots somewhere else. This kind of word is called mushtaq, meaning it's a word, but it has its origin in some other word. It's based on some other word, and that word gets modified and, you know, transformed into a series of other vocabulary. Then there are words that are original. You cannot trace them back to another word. They are the way they are, and there's no going back. These are originals, untraceable words, and these are asma jamida, jamid. Jamid means you can't go back. There's no building blocks. It is what it is. You know, it's like comparing a rock to a wall to a boulder. A wall is made up of bricks, but a boulder is a boulder. It's not made up of parts. So ism jamid is not made up of parts, but ism mushtaq is made up of parts. I'm giving you this basic introduction because there's a disagreement among linguists, grammarians, right? People of sarf, people of morphology, about the origin of the word Allah. Is it mushtaq? Is it derived from another word? Or is it jamid? Is it unique by itself? You cannot trace it to another root origin. Both opinions have existed in our history. Both have been attributed to some very, very high level scholars. So we can't say one is right and wrong. I wouldn't go that far. I can't, as part of intellectual honesty though, I do have to tell you which one I tend to agree with more. But that doesn't mean that I completely disregard the other side. So I'll give you evidences for both. The group that says it is mushtaq, that it is derived from another word, say that the root origin of the word Allah is the word ilah.
the word ilah, like la ilaha illallah. So the word ilah, if you put al on it, al ilah becomes Allah. The alif gets removed. The alif gets removed. This, you know, this hadf of it, and the word fuses together, and the word Allah is formed. That's the opinion of those who say it's rooted in. The root letters are Hamza, Lam, and Ha. And from it, two verbs come. Alaha ya'lahu and aliha ya'lahu. Alaha ya'lahu literally means to worship. So ilah is the entity that is the focus of worship and obedience. That's one meaning of the word ilah. But aliha, not with a fatha like alaha, but aliha, the verb, actually is used in another case. It's used for a child that is thirsty for the milk of its mother and is desperately running towards that mother. And from it derives the verbal meaning is the one to whom people desperately turn. The one, the ilah is someone to, you know, and ilha actually is the masdar form, is the one to whom people desperately turn. And so scholars say that this is the origin of the word ilah, the one to be worshipped, the one to be obeyed, and the one to whom people turn out of desperation. There is nowhere else to turn but he. Right? These are the origins of the word Allah. The other group says no. This is not the origin of the word Allah. The word Allah is the universal word for Allah and isn't even limited to Arabic. It is the word for Allah in every language. And it is the word Allah that it's the word for himself, the proper name for Allah that he revealed to all the messengers in every language. In every language. Now, on the one hand, it sounds like this is more of a spiritual thing and that's more of a linguistic thing. But this group also gives linguistic evidences, and at least I'd like you to know some of them. If the word is based on the word ilah, then it's made up, it's a composite of two things, al and ilah, right? It's two things. Now in the Arabic language, when you call someone, you use the word ya. Like you could say ya walad, ya rajul, right? When you call on Allah, when you call on Allah, what do you say then? Ya Allah, ya Allah. Now in the Arabic language, when you call someone, you cannot use al. Like I can't say Ya Al-Walad, that doesn't make sense. You can only say what? Ya Walad. You cannot say, for example, Ya Ar-Rahim. Even if you're calling Allah, you can't say Ya Ar-Rahim. What do you have to say? Ya Rahim. You know, Ya Quddus, Ya Salam. You have to call Allah, if you're calling Allah with Harf Nida, with Ya, then the Al cannot be there. This is a principle of Arabic language. So, when we say Ya Allah, Ya Allah, clearly the Al is still there. And if it's still there, it must be there because it's not really an al. It's part of the word. That's the argument linguistically made. The fact that we use ya and then we use the word Allah, you know, if that al really was part of al ilah, then we would call him ya ilah. But we would not say ya Allah. Right? So the fact that in nida we use ya Allah in and of itself is a linguistic evidence. Then the second linguistic evidence is that the word Allah is not used generically anywhere in the Quran. Whenever the word Allah is used, it's not used as the one worthy of worship, it's used as Allah, as his name, as a proper name. And the biggest proof of that is the Fatiha itself. You know, Allah Azza wa Jal says, Bismillah, even in the beginning, the Basmala, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim are descriptions, but the word Allah itself is the one being described. Allah is the noun and Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim are the adjectives. Alhamdulillah, Allah is the noun, Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawmiddin, adjectives. So that's the second argument, that in and of itself it's not used in a generic sense anywhere. It's only used in this proper form. In this proper form. And then the third, when they said, who is your Lord, who is your Master? Describe him to us. Whenever a question is asked, who is he? Who do you worship? What do you worship? You don't start with a description, you start with the name. So this surah begins, Hu Allah, Ahad. Al-Ahad can be a description, Al-Samad can be a description, right? But Allah itself is the proper name. This is the third. And then of course Aramaic and Hebrew also have original words. The word Allah has occurred in original forms in their languages as well. In their languages as well. So there are several lines of evidence, and the final, I just might as well mention it since we're on the subject, is the fact that we call on Allah saying Allahumma, Allahumma, and that's a unique phrase, and then Lam and Alif together are never heavy. If you put Alif, Lam with a Shadda and Alif, you say Allah, Allah. But what do we say when we pronounce Allah, we make it heavy, we break the norm of the Arabic language for this word. It defies all principles of the Arabic language. So that for that reason alone, it is considered universal. Now that brings up a side thing. I'll only mention it briefly because we have to get to the dars of the surah itself. And the brief comment is the following. If you say that this word is even beyond the Arabic language, then there's the problem of mamnu' min as-sarf. What that means is, when a word comes from another language into Arabic, then you cannot put three harakat on it. You can't put dhamma, fatha, and kasra on it. The kasra is, the E is not allowed. But do you find the word Allah with kasra in it? You do, right? So for example, وَمَنْ أَصْدَقُ مِنَ اللَّهِ مِنَ اللَّهِ, there's a kasra on the word Allah. So it's mu'rab, it's not a foreign word, it's a completely Arabized word. So if it is from every language, and if it's the word taught to all messengers, even the ones that were non-Arab, how can it have all the kasras? And the response to that given by the ulama of languages, there's only one word that has to be universal to all languages. And that word can only be what? Allah. It's not a foreign. Foreign things are that which is alien to me and it's local to you. But what word is local to every language? Who is local to every language? Allah Azza wa Jal. So there's no the concept of it being foreign doesn't apply when we deal with the lafz al-jalala. Anyhow, so that was a little bit of a distinction. Now we begin. Qul, say. This does two things. This of course is a command to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We talked about qul before. But what does it do? Two things. One, these are lessons for the Messenger. And two, these are lessons. This is teacher training. This is what you go out and say. This is what you need to go and teach the people. Whenever you find قُل in the Qur'an, it is a lesson for the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it's also what he must go out and teach. What he must go out and preach. He must declare it. He can't just keep it to himself. You know, اِعْلَمْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. No, he is Allah the One. Or he's unique. That's just for him to know. But قُل, he has to spread it. He has to get it out there. So from the beginning, there's the message of Tawheed connected with the message of Da'wah. That's how this surah begins. قُل هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. Now, the word هُوَ. Most mufassirun say هُوَ is لفظ الشأن here. Meaning even if you don't have the word هُوَ there, the sentence is complete. قُلِ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. Say Allah is one. That's still a sentence. But what's the word هُوَ doing there? The word he, I'm translating it as he, a pronoun is used when you are talking about something that's already known. In other words, if I was just talking to you right now and I say, you know, he graduated from college. If I, out of nowhere, I just said to you, he graduated from college, what question would pop in your mind? Man, who are you talking about? I don't know who he is. But when there's a he that doesn't even need to be mentioned who it is ahead of time, it's so obvious who the subject is, and it's so universally, his greatness is so universally acknowledged that there is no mention to name him first. You can just say he, and everybody's like, yeah, I know who you're talking about. This is called sha'n. Because of the universally known greatness of the subject at hand, you can just say huwa. And so this is for describing the greatness of Allah Azza wa Jal that the word huwa occurs. Of course, huwa also because it's the answer to their questions. Man huwa? Ma huwa? Who is he? What is he? What are his descriptions? And huwa, that which you asked about is Allah, huwa Allah, huwa Allah. And then there's the word ahad. Now another grammatical breakdown, and if you take huwa as sha'n, then what happens is Allah, mubtada, ahad, khabar. Those of you who know a little bit of Arabic, subject, predicate. Right? Allah is, and I haven't described ahad yet, it's a beautiful word, but we haven't come to that yet. Another description is that huwa is mubtada, huwa is the first part of the sentence. Allah, the word Allah is khabar, and ahad is khabar thani. What that means in English translation is, say, he is Allah, and then say, he is Ahad. There were two sentences fused into one. When you have two khabar, that's what happens linguistically. Two sentences are fused into one. And the way we would translate them is, he is Allah, comma, one. And I actually, one is really not a good translation of Ahad, but I'm sticking to it for now before I describe further to you, inshallah ta'ala. So he is Allah, one. Now, the first thing we need to know is the difference between wahid and ahad. Wahid and ahad. The word ahad is, the word wahid, you know, wahid, ithnain, thalath, this is what? One. Wahid means one. So how come Allah doesn't say, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ wahid? Say Allah is one. That would also mean one. You see, first of all, let's take it from a negative point of view so you understand it better. In the Arabic language, certain words can be used only in a particular way and not in any other way. If I say, for example, right now, لَيْسَ وَاحِدٌ مَوْجُودًا فِي الْمَسْجِدِ لَيْسَ وَاحِدٌ
ليس واحد في المسجد. No one, there's not one in the masjid. You know what that means? There's not one, but there's two, three, four, five. In other words, what I'm saying is there isn't just one, there may be even more. As opposed to that, if I say, لَيْسَ أَحَدْ مَوْجُودًا فِي الْمَسْجِدِ, you know what that means? There's not a single person in the masjid. There's no one in the... When you say واحد, then the meaning would be, there isn't just one in the masjid, there could be more. There's not just one. So you're saying it's not one, it's more. But when you say, لَيْسَ أَحَدْ, then what are you saying? There's absolutely no one in the masjid at all. Ahad is used negatively only. It's not used in a positive sense. It's only used not anyone at all. وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا. Let no one at all commit shirk with Allah. Not no one at all. So that ahad is an absolute negation. That's where ahad is used. It's not used in a positive. When you want to speak in the positive, you use wahid. When you want to speak in the negative, you use ahad, especially the exclusive, the absolute kind of negative. That's the first thing. But the thing is, in this surah, ahad is not being used in the negative, it's being used in the positive. So it's already unique. It's not something that normally happens in Arabic. The only other, so it's ahad is used in the negative. The second place ahad is used is in idafa. Ahadukum. Ayawaddu ahadukum. Right? Would any of you like? أن يأكل لحم أخيه ميتا فكرهتموه in Surah Al-Hujurat. Would any of you like, would any one of you like that they would eat the flesh of their dead brother, etc. Right? That أحدكم, when it's one of. Now I'm saying إضافة, that's the technical term. The English term is one of. So one of them, one of you, one of the Muslims. أحد المسلمين, أحدكم, أحدهما. Right? So إما يبلغن عندك الكبر أحدهما أو كلاهما. When it's idafa, then you can use ahad. When there's a combination of two, then you can use ahad. By itself, it's only used in the negative. If you want to use it in the positive, you have to add something else to it. It becomes part of something else. One of, or the first of, etc., etc. The only place in Arabic literature where this word is used in the positive without any further attribution is Suratul Ikhlas. That's it. There's nowhere else. Some oversimplify it and say, Ahad is not used for anyone other than Allah. That's not clear enough. Ahad is used for other than Allah. But the word Ahad in the positive, without any idafa in it, in that way linguistically, is never ever used for anyone other than Allah. So now, we know the difference between Wahid and Ahad a little bit. I still haven't clarified it yet. And hopefully before the salah at least I'll get that much across. What is the difference between wahid and ahad? The original word is actually wahd and wahad. There are two variations of it in sarf. Wahd and wahad. And so that word, what does it mean? I'm going to give you the meaning of it from the dictionary. Huwa wahdun munfaridun bi nafsihi. Wahd means someone who is individual by himself. Rajulun wahad ay la yu'rafu nasabuhu wa la asluhu. A person who is wahad, wahad with a waw, is someone whose tribe and his lineage and his origin is not known. That's wahad. But that is used for a person. Allah refuses to even use that because in the language that can be used for a person. So He uses a word for Himself that is not used for any person, ahad, in the positive. And so the word ahad is even the, you could argue it's the hyperbolized, the enhanced form of the word wahad. Imam Raghib al-Isfahani in his famous book, Mufradatul Quran, even went as far as to say that ahad is a separate root from wahad. You know, most say that ahad comes from the root origin, waw, ha, and dal. But Imam Raghib says, no, ahad is a separate entity by itself. And I'll give you his definition also. He says, أي المنفرد لا نظير له وليس له معه غيره. There is nothing that can be compared to an ahad. There is a unique, singular soul entity to which there is no comparison possible, and there is no competitor possible, and there is no antonym or opposite possible. There is nothing possible in terms of any sort of affiliation with this one. The one that has no second is ahad. The one for whom the second is impossible. That's ahad. Now, this word used for Allah Azza wa Jal creates, you know, earthquakes in Arab society. They have gods, they believe in gods, but for their gods there's also another god.
I can have my God and you can have yours. And their concept of Allah is that, yeah, Allah is there, but he has, you know, angels, he took as daughters, ma'adallah, or the Christian community said he took a son, or the Jewish community, a fraction of them, not all of them, a fraction of them said, Uzair has been taken as a son of Allah, so they attributed sons and daughters to Allah. In Hindu tradition, what do? In some of the Hindu traditions, they say God became the universe, so God is in the bug and in the tree and in the rock and the stone, and God is running in my veins and all of this stuff, right? This is similar to American transcendentalism more recently in the late 1800s, early 1900s, right? In American literature also, God is in the tree or in nature or in us and et cetera, et cetera. This idea. But which kind of, you know, and if you do that, if you say anything about Allah Azza wa Jalla that starts comparing him or pairing him or affiliating him with anything else, what is lost is ahad. And if you separate Allah from all attributions of human beings, you separate Him completely from all attributions that are shared by any creation, then what you get to is ahad. It is a unique concept of the oneness of Allah. This is the concept that even Christians don't agree with. Even Jews don't agree with. They don't agree with this concept. They'll say, Huwallahu wahid, fine. When you study their aqidah, when you study their creed, wahid, they will not have a problem. What do they have a problem with? Ahad. With ahad. And here before the salah, at least one part of the word ahad I want to help you understand inshallah ta'ala, because these are things that have to be clear in our minds, and I don't take a conventional approach to teaching concepts in aqidah and theology, but I do want you to have a basic, easy to understand logical foundation, that even if you don't have the technical terminology, you don't fall into categories of shirk. One of the easiest places where people can be confused is when a word is used for Allah and is also used for us. For example, Allah calls Himself Alim, knowledgeable. Have you ever heard that word being used for a person also? That person is knowledgeable? Sure, sure. Allah calls Himself Hakim, full of wisdom, wise, wise. Have you ever heard the word Hakim being used for a person also? It's possible. Allah says, for example, He says He is Rahim, Rahim, merciful. Can you describe a person as merciful also? Sami', listening. You can describe a person as listening also. Basir. Basir. Right? Basir is someone who can see. Allah describes Himself as someone who sees. Can you use that word for a human being also? Yes, you can. This is a problem because now the same word is being used for Allah and the same being used for a human being. Now where's the only word that's only used for Allah and can never be used for a human being as a description? Ahad. That's the word, right? And As-Samad, as we'll see. These words are unshared. Everything about this surah is unshared. You will find other attributes of Allah in other surahs. But those attributes, what you'll learn about them is, it's possible that in some way, shape or form, those attributes can also be used for people. Like Allah's name, Ra'uf. Ra'uf, compassionate. Is used in the Qur'an for the messenger. بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفُ الرَّحِيمُ. So how do we understand that? How do we clearly understand when a word is being used for Allah and can also be used for other than Allah, how do we not end up doing shirk? What I'd like you to remember is three differences. If you remember three things, you'll never fall into shirk. The first difference. Let's take one name, so we can use that as a sample, and it works for all the other names of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Let's take the name knowledgeable. Allah is knowledgeable. We say that if that name is being used for Allah, then that power that Allah has, that knowledge that Allah has no beginning and has no ending. The knowledge of Allah has no beginning and no ending. Compare that to my knowledge and your knowledge or the knowledge of all creation put together. What does it have? It has a beginning and it has an ending. So the first difference is, it's infinite. Allah timeless actually. No beginning, no ending. And ours is temporary, timed, caged. That's one big difference. The second difference. Allah's knowledge has no limits. He knows everything. Absolutely everything. There's nothing that He doesn't know. As opposed to your knowledge and my knowledge, what does it necessarily have? Limits. I don't know what's behind this wall. I don't know. I don't know how many heartbeats I have left on this earth. I don't know. I don't know what will happen in the next 30 minutes. I don't have any knowledge. I have knowledge, but I don't have all knowledge, as opposed to Allah who has all knowledge. So the first difference was no beginning and no end, as opposed to me. The second difference is there is no limit to Allah's knowledge, whereas any other knowledge will have limits. And here's the third and most important difference. This is the third one. The third one is, everything I have, every attribute I have, let's talk about knowledge, is not something I own, it was given to me. It's not something I had to begin with, it was given to me. I wasn't born with it, I didn't have it, it was given to me. As opposed to Allah, when you talk about His knowledge, it is His own and it is not what? It is not given to Him by anyone, it is His own. It is His own. Now think of any attribute. Let's think about the attribute of power. Allah is Al-Qawi. You can have a person who's strong, he has some power. But the power of Allah has no beginning and no end. But the power of a person has a beginning and an end. The power of Allah is infinite. It has no limits. It's limitless. But the power of a human being has limits. And it's limited. And then the power of Allah is His own. He didn't get it from anyone else. It's His own. But the power of a human being comes from who? From Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He gets it from Him. You keep these three distinctions in mind and you will maintain what Allah calls ahad. He cannot be compared. He is unique. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There will never be any attributions or anything compared to Him. This is the remarkable lesson inside this absolutely beautiful, stunning word that Allah uses for Himself in the Qur'an. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. Now, you know, Allah put in the word أَحَدٌ, there is no alif lam. But in the word الصَّمَدْ, there is alif lam. اللَّهُ الصَّمَدْ. We don't say اللَّهُ صَمَدٌ. We say Allahu as-samad. But when we say ahad, what do we say? Ahadun, we don't say al-ahad, right? So why not put al over there too, and why put al over here? This is a grammatical difference, and it has some rhetorical benefits. The first benefit is, أَنَّ الْمُرَادْ هُوَ التَّنْكِيرَ عَلَى سَبِيلِ التَّعْظِيمِ, the Arab would say. That putting the nakira puts an exclamation mark on the statement. He is Allah ahad. Just think about that. How amazing that is. And that can be done in ancient Arabic with a tanween. So I can't do, you and I can't do that in English, so I have to raise my volume and pound on the podium and mess up the recording to get that across. What Allah is saying when He says ahad, the power of that word is manifest in that tanween. That's the first thing. The second is that tanween is used conventionally for a khabar, the predicate of a sentence. And a khabar is used when someone asks a question. And of course, ahad was the response to a question, who is Allah? And to appropriately answer the question, the alif lam is not there, you have to put the tanween there. So what the second benefit of it addresses it, it's ikhbar. It's giving the news to those who seek this news. Who is this Allah? The thing to know about Him is ahad. And this is the sticking point. This is the one that will get you beatings. This is the one that will get Bilal radiallahu anhu tortured, and the boulders on his chest, and the only words coming out of his mouth are what? Ahad, ahad. Those are the only words coming out of his mouth. This is the point of contention. Saying Allah is not the problem. Even they accepted Allah. They refused to accept ahad. They refused to accept ahad. Subhanallah. What an amazing word Allah gave us. You know, there's one story I have to share with you. This is, you know, a friend of mine, he's going to hate it because he's going to watch this and he's going to hate me for it. But I'll have to say this. It's a good friend of mine from Arkansas. Took Shahada. I talk about him all the time, actually. But I'll tell you again. He was a philosophy major, master's degree in philosophy. Your typical upscale, you know, he calls himself, I was a yuppie, he calls himself. White guy, you know, white family, you know, his wife is also, you know, Anglo-Saxon, if you will, right? And they lived in Arkansas. She's I think, doing a PhD in biomedicine. He did his master's in philosophy. He was a librarian at the university. Very philosophical guy, you know? And part of his philosophy major was philosophy of religion. So he studied all these different religions, including, of course, Islam. So they were both agnost. You know what agnosts are? We're not sure if there is a God. We're not sure if there's not a God. We're just chilling. That's an agnost, right? So he was an agnost. So he's married to his wife and they have their first son. When they have their son, Tristan, his umbilical cord was tied around his neck several times over. Right? And that's normally what happens when that happens. At childbirth, the child chokes to death. But the child survives. When the child, he sees this happen with his own eyes, he says, there has to be a God. There has to be. He says that the agnost leaves agnosticism and says, there has to be a God. And so what does he do? He takes his old notes, takes the dust off of his notebook and starts going through his old notes on world religions, right? So he's taking notes on Catholicism and Protestantism and, you know, various forms of Hinduism and Buddhism and Taoism. Ah, there you go, Islam.
So he looks at his own notes from years ago on Islam and he reads this. His own writing. This Tawheed thing is awesome. That's what he had written in his own notes, in his own words. This Tawheed thing sounds pretty amazing. And this was his commentary on Ikhlas. Right? And he came to Deen. So he's a principal of an Islamic school now. Alhamdulillah. But, you know, when you study world religions, you will think at face value, what will seem like, yeah, we all believe in one God. It's all the same. They believe in God too. They believe in a merciful God and a powerful God. It will seem to you at face value that yes, we all share one faith. But when it comes to studying Ahad carefully, you will realize how every other religion and every other worldview just starts falling off to the sides. And the only thing left standing is this deen. This La ilaha illallah. This Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's unique. Even when it comes to belief in God. Your co-worker will tell you, yeah, I believe in God too. No. They can believe in some God, yeah. But in Allahu Ahad, not yet. Not yet. And we haven't explored what that really means. I'm just looking at it linguistically right now. Theologically, what does it mean? Psychologically, what does it mean? We haven't even explored that yet. We will, inshallah ta'ala, after the salah. But I want to wrap up with one thing, inshallah ta'ala, which is tied to this, so that you have something to ponder over when we make salah. And hopefully the Imam will grace us with the Sultul Ikhlas. This idea of Ahad, one. There's one of the great writers on Islamic theology in Pakistan, actually. Rafi'uddin, Dr. Rafi'uddin, commenting on this surah, said something amazing. And I really appreciated it because I think for modern audiences, this kind of stuff needs to be said and heard. Allah created the human being with the knowledge of himself. The human being knew already there is this highest ideal, Allah Azza wa Jal. And not just that there is a God and He created us and now we can do whatever we want. No, He's the Rabb, He's the Master. My goal in life is to do what He wants. This is my highest ideal. My greatest accomplishment ever can be that I become His slave. That would be the greatest honor I can have. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his greatest honor, Subhanalladhi asra bi abdihi. He becomes abd of Allah. The slave of Allah is a great honor. That's the goal in life. And Allah pre-programmed that goal inside every single human being. But if you lose sight of that goal, it is like this, you know, you have this thirst, this hunger inside you to fulfill that goal. Allah created you with that. But when your appetite is not filled with healthy food, what do you fill it with? If you don't get the right meal, are you going to say, I'm not going to eat at all? No. When a person is starving and there's no food of their preference, or there's no healthy food, there's even filth, barks of trees, will the human being still start chewing on that when it comes to that? They will. When you lose sight of Allah Azza wa Jal, and that no longer is your goal, then necessarily you will find a replacement. Necessarily. It is necessary to have something you aspire towards. That is the mission of your life. So the one who has found Allah, what happens to them? Inna salati wa nusuki wa mahyaya wa mamati lillahi rabbil alameen. It's very simple for them. The one who has really found Allah, their salah is for Allah, their sacrifice is for Allah, their life and their death is now for Allah. The way they live, the way they eat, the way they sleep, what they want to do with their life, their long-term goals, their short-term goals, what are they going to do with their kids, why are they getting an education, where are they going to work, everything is now for Allah, that is their goal. But for the one who doesn't have that goal, they have to find another goal. And in old times, there used to be idols, there used to be other religions, you find some other god. But in our times, it's become far more pathetic. Far more pathetic. Now you have someone who's obsessed with their body, and they're working out 18 hours a day. And their only goal in life, is to just keep getting buffer and buffer. It's the only goal. Take steroids and look sharp, stay on top. Keep in shape. Or there's this goal they set with their trainer. I got to do this many reps. Or I got to do this many push-ups. Or I got to get bench press this many pounds, etc. That's their goal. That has become their ilah. For a person that their life has become about money. Have you met people? They cannot talk about anything except their work. They can't. Yeah, I work at this company. I do this. And the moment they lose their job, they become suicidal. Because that's all they ever thought about. That's all they ever did with their life. That's all they ever did. That becomes their goal. For some people, it's their children. They live for their children. They do everything for their children. Day and night, they think about their children. There is no other thought running in their mind. There is no other goal before them than their children. That is all they run after. When you don't find him, you will find something else. You will find something else, and you will run after it. And you will give your life to it. And this is it, there is no exception among human beings. And today, it could be even a slacker. You could ask me, what about a slacker? You know those kids that play 20 hours of video games a day and don't get off the couch? Well, what is their goal? It is to entertain themselves. It is to fry their brain cells behind a screen. That is their ultimate goal. That is what they want to reach. And they're working hard to attain it every day. Right? That's what it becomes. These are the psychological implications of understanding Tawheed. It is easy to say Allah is one. But is He one in my life? Is He the one for me? Or do I have some other one that I'm running after? Or some other thing that I've put before myself? Allah asked this question rhetorically. He says, مَا غَرَّكَ بِرَبِّكَ الْكَرِيمِ. What deluded you from your gracious master? What was so important to you that you ran after, that you couldn't come after this? SubhanAllah. SubhanAllah. So when he uses this word, هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٍ, it's psychological implications. It's implications on our attitude towards Allah. And how we think about our life completely changes. Now there is nothing more important to me than making him happy. Nothing more important to me than him being pleased with me. Nothing more important to me than he forgiving me. Nothing more important to me than he would talk to me on the Day of Judgment telling me that I'm successful. He will look towards me. I will not be from the ones he turns away from. وَلَا يُكَلِّمُهُمُ اللَّهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Allah will not talk to them on the Day of Judgment. May Allah not make us from those people. These are some of the psychological implications of just internalizing أحد. أحد. Just that word. What Allah is saying. This is who Allah is. This is what He's supposed to do. And I want to conclude, because it's time for Salah, with the following. This is the... I can't quote Iqbal because I'm terrible at Urdu, but I'll tell you the meaning of the verse. Okay? Though I like the verse myself. So it's poetry. But he says, what used to be, he's talking about, it's a poem about Tawheed. It's a poem about Tawheed. And he says, what used to be something that burned in the hearts of men, is now a subject of abstract philosophical debate. That's what he says. Now what is Tawheed to us today? Debates. Discussions. Abstract discussions in theology that have no end to them. No end to them. But what it used to be was something that burned inside the hearts. Am I fulfilling the rights of Ahad yet? Am I doing justice to that Ahad yet? May Allah make us of the people of Tawheed. May Allah give us in our hearts what burned, the likes of which burned in the heart of Ibrahim alayhi salam and the Messenger of Allah and the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in. We'll continue the dars on Surah Al-Ikhlas after the salah. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim wa nafa'ni wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikr al-Hakim. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله ثم أما بعد. We are moving on to the phrase or the ayah, the second ayah of Surah Al-Ikhlas, Allahu Samad. We're going to first look at a basic definition of As-Samad. As-Samad al-ay al-kafi. As-Samad is the one who is enough. Alladhi yarji'una ilayhi idha ihtajuhu. The one who they return to whenever they have a need of him. Huwa alladhi yakfihim. He is the one who is enough for them. Wa yasuddu hajatihim wa as'ilatahum alladhi yasmiduna ilayhi. And he is the one who fulfills all of their needs and their answers all of their questions, the ones that they attribute to him or turn to him with عند الحاجة, at the time of need. هذا معنى الصمد. This is the meaning of صمد في اللغة. صمد إليه أي توجه إليه. And linguistically speaking, when you use the word صمد as a verb, it means to turn attention towards someone. وطلب منه الحاجة, or to demand from them the fulfillment of a need. المصمود إليه هو السيد. المتوجه إليه. المصمود is the word مصمود is actually what صمد implies, is the one to whom people turn in time of need.
another meaning. So that's one meaning I'd like you to remember. Samad, one you turn to in time of need. The second meaning. Samada ilayhi ay qasadahu. The second verbal meaning is when you make someone your goal, that you aspire to reach them, or you aspire to please them, or you aspire to attain them, etc., etc. When you attribute someone as your goal, they become a samad. So Allah is saying that He is the one we turn to in need, and He's also calling Himself the ultimate goal. He is the goal of what we do. And of course, this is one of the reasons this is called Suratul Ikhlas, because sincerity, ikhlas, is when we do things and the goal of it is always Allah Azza wa Jal. So that's included in the meaning of as-samad. وَالصَّمَدْ أَيْضًا الْغَنِيِّ الَّذِي لَيْسَ فَوْقَهُ أَحَدٍ. One of the meanings of samad also is the one who is not in need of anyone else, and no one can overpower them or be above them in status or in any attribute. الَّذِي لَا عَيْبَ فِيهِ, the one who has no blemishes or no faults in him. مِنَ الرِّجَالِ الَّذِي لَيْسَ فَوْقَهُ أَحَدٍ. It's used also in Arabic literature, it's used for a person also, the one who cannot be overcome. Meaning can't be overcome in battle, you can't outdo them in business or in their leadership or in their eloquence. Then they're also called a fixture, a samad. Okay, so this is from a linguistic point of view. Additionally, Mufassirun comment, as-samad implies azimul jalala. That's one thing, that he's incredible and great in terms of his glory. الدائم الخالد, he's the everlasting. المقصود لقضاء الحاجات, we talked about that, the one who is turned to fulfill needs. This is important now. شيءٌ صمد, the word صمد is used as an adjective also, something that is صمد. مصمت لا جوف فيه أو جوف له. It is referred to as something that is solid with no holes or emptiness inside, something that is through and through pure one thing, like a pure brick of gold could be samad, or a boulder with no possibility of any air or water getting in could also be called, an attribute of it could be samad, meaning something absolute and concrete without any flaw, right? That's one of the meanings. And this meaning is important to appreciate because we give Allah Azza wa Jal names. And a name is like the shell, it's the outside. But then Allah Azza wa Jal actually manifests and fulfills every one of the names we give Him. And He fulfills them in the absolute sense. Is it possible that you give someone a name like noble? That's what you call them on the outside, but on the inside they're really not that noble. It's possible, right? You call someone powerful, but on the inside there's still weakness. It's possible. But when we call Allah any name, now because He is as-samad, He fulfills that name in the absolute sense. Which is why I gave you that three distinctions earlier on. This is part of now as-samad. Grammatically speaking, Allahu as-samad plays a very interesting role in the surah. One grammatical explanation of Allahu as-samad is that it is al-badal, it is a replacement of the original subject of the sentence, Allah. Meaning, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدُ أَحَدْ. It's replacing the mubtada, the original mubtada, and this is badal also. Okay. In other words, Allah the Absolute is the only one for which there can be no second. So it's further explaining that first sentence. This is tafsir of the first ayah by the second ayah. You know? This is one way it's understood. The other, the way it's understood is that it's going further from where it began and it's repeating the word Allah again because Allah is giving Himself descriptions that the Arabs who talked about Allah did not give Him. They would also say Allah created, they would also say Allah is merciful. What they wouldn't say is Ahad or Samad. So he's mentioning Allah, Ahad, Allah, As-Samad. And As-Samad has Alif Lam in it, which is for absolute istighraq. You know, it's absolutely, in no way, shape or form is there anything left in his, you know, in the word Samad. And the basic meaning of Samad that gets repeated by Mufassirun over and over again, in addition to what we just discussed, the one who everyone needs, and needs no one himself. That is as-samad. One of the interesting commentaries by Al-Biqa'i rahimahullah in his tafsir Nazm al-Durar fi tanasub al-ayati was-sur, commenting on the previous surah, which was the previous surah? Surah Lahab. Surah Lahab talked about a person who thinks he needs no one. Everybody needs him because he was the treasurer. Who are we talking about? Abu Lahab. And Allah is even, after he's done with, now you should know, the only one that is actually as-samad is Allah Azza wa Jal. So there's this contrast. Well, now that his filthy, self-absorbed concept, because he was self-absorbed, his ilah was himself. He worshipped himself. He didn't even worship any other religion. And you have to remember what he said when the messenger invited him to the religion. You know, there's one time he cursed the messenger himself, we reminded ourselves. تَبَّلَّكْ أَلِهَذَا جَمَعْتَنَا. May you be cursed, may you be destroyed, did you gather us for this? But this other time he cursed the religion. And when he cursed the religion, what was his criticism? تَبَّلْ لِهَذَا الدِّينِ أَنْ أَكُونَ سَوَاءَ. You know, لِهَؤُلَاء, I will become equal to these people? You want me to accept that religion where I will have an equal because he thinks he has no equal? Now Allah is teaching us the only one who has no equal is He. He's the only one absolute and He's the only one that is ahad. Now we get to the logical conclusion. لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ. There are several things to note here. We'll go through them one by one. The first thing to note here, what is the connection between the previous ayah and Allah saying He did not give birth to anyone, He didn't father anyone? Nor is he fathered himself, nor is he, the old English term, he didn't beget, nor was he begotten. And I'm using was carefully, because Allah doesn't say, la yalidu, wa la yuladu. La would have been present tense. He does not beget, he is not begotten. Allah used lam. And lam forces the meaning of a verb to the past tense. It forces, so I'm translating, he did not beget, he did not father, nor was he fathered. So the first thing we have to figure out is the benefit of the past tense in this ayah. Why use the past tense? Why not say he does not father and he is not fathered? Why not? Well, the latter makes logical sense. The fact, lam yulad, he wasn't born of anyone, makes sense because birth happens in the past. So that makes sense. But why not protect shirk from the future too by saying la yalid? He does not give birth. Well, one of the problems with that would have been, if you say he does not give birth, that doesn't necessarily negate that he did not give. He did not father. So that leaves room for shirk in the past. That's one thing. The second thing is, we've already said ahad and as-samad, which means already there's not going to be anyone comparable. Having a child, what does it do? A human being begets a human being. A cat gives birth to a cat, you know, a dog to a dog. An animal gives birth to an equal, to someone of the same species. We've already established he can't have a second. That's not possible for him. And this attribution of Allah having ma'adallah a son, like the Christian community or some segments of the Jewish community, or Allah having daughters like some segments of the mushrikun who said that he took angels as daughters, these attributes were not made of the present or the future. Where were these allegations made from? Of the past. Isa alayhi salam, Uzair alayhi salam, the angels. All of these concepts are relegated to the past. One of the benefits of this past tense is Allah is addressing the falsehoods of the religions that already occurred. And in it, like Abu Bakr al-Baqillani actually commenting on Lam Yalid said, in it there's a miracle of the Qur'an in regards to its predictions. There will be no other religion that claims that God has children that will ever take hold on the earth, like which religions already took hold? Christianity at the heart of it, right? Think of other religions that have a concept of God where He gives birth to another. All of them are relegated to what? Pre-Islam. Pretty much all of them pre-Islam. So now here, Allah addresses that with the problem that already occurs, the problem that already exists in the people, which is that He already had a child. So now in the Quran, for example, Walad Allah, mentioned in the past, and they say that Allah has begotten a son. Then Allah Azza wa Jalla says, Ja'alu abna'an lillah. They took sons for Allah. Qalu attakhadha Allahu waladan. Similarly, Allah Azza wa Jalla mentions, He says, Anna yakunu lahu walad wa lam takun lahu sahiba. How can he have a son when he doesn't even have an associate, meaning a spouse? And the word spouse, one word for that is sahiba, another is kufu, and that's coming in the surah. Wa lam yakun lahu kufuwan ahad. That's coming in this surah. But then what I wanted to bring to your attention is something that is not often overlooked when we study lam yalid wa lam yulad. It's very clear to a Muslim. Allah Azza wa Jal does not share attributes with His creation. Giving birth, having a child, or being born Himself means you have a beginning and an end. When you're born, you will also die. And when you were born, which means you didn't exist at some point. And that takes away from Godhood itself, from divinity itself. So we never attribute those things to Allah. That's very simple. But that's when we talk about Allah Azza wa Jal. But doing this kind of shirk also has a psychological disease, you can call it a disease of the heart, if you want to use spiritual terms, associated with it. And I want to bring that to light. What is the disease of the heart? Not the disease of the mind, but of the heart that is associated with saying that Allah has a son. What comes with that? Look, I'll give you a worldly example. Imagine that you got a job, and the boss is really strict. But the manager under the boss is your cousin. And he likes you. Okay, so the boss is strict, but the manager is a cool guy, and he's your cousin, you hang out with him, and he's good with you. Okay, so when you slack off at work, what are you hoping for? Even if you get in trouble, who's going to come in the way? Your cousin is going to come in and say, look, this guy's with me. He's okay. Even if the boss is strict, the manager will deal with it. I don't have to deal with it. But I'm really not talking about a manager or your cousin. I'm talking about why people do shirk. One of the core psychological reasons people do shirk. They figure Allah will exact justice. He created me, He gave me. I'm going to have to answer for the things He gave me. I don't know if I want to do that. But if he has a son, or he has someone he loves, and I make sure I make them happy, I don't have to make him happy, I just have to make them happy, then what's going to happen on the Day of Judgment? If he comes after me, who's going to come in between? No. I got these guys. They're with me. It's okay. Let them slide. Right? That is the psychology of shirk. Now, the previous ayah said, the one who everyone should turn to is As-Samad. What does it mean? The one who everyone turns to? The one who everyone, part of the meaning, everyone turns to? And Allah is saying, if you only should be turning to me, there's no need for you to give me a son and a daughter. There's no need for you to put anyone in between. Why did the mushrikun put idols in between? Why? Because they will make a good case before Allah. That's what they will do. Set someone up in between you and Allah. And by the way, even the Muslims who commit shirk, who go and worship graves, and you know, make dua to people that have passed away, why do they do that? Because they have haram businesses. They know they're doing really bad stuff. So they can't fess up to Allah. So what do? Let's set up someone in between. I'm going to donate like 50% of my liquor store earnings to this, to this grave over here, or this whatever temple. And then this guy, hopefully, will make a good case with me. For me. You know, that's the psychology of shirk. So because Allah used the word As-Samad for him, there's no base left now. You can't turn to anyone other than Allah because He is As-Samad. He's the absolute one to be turned to. And so this is a logical continuity. This removes from the people the need to attribute such things to Allah Azza wa Jal. So now we come to the final ayah, وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. Now if he doesn't give birth and he's not begotten himself, the word kufu in Arabic is used for spouse, but more than that, interestingly in Arabic literature, kufu is also used for your enemy that's equal to you in battle. Like two guys that are equally good in a fight, like the younger guys don't hear no Ken and Ryu, right? So if you're equally good, then kufu. And it's also used in marriage. I don't know why they made the parallel, but it tells you a lot about Arab marriages back in the day, I guess. But what it is when someone is comparable to you, toe-to-toe with you, in modern expression, toe-to-toe with you, someone who is on par with you, comparable to you, has the same skills, has the same status, has the same ranking as yourself, such a person is called kufu. And so you marry someone who is compatible with you, the same as you, the same level of intellect, the same, circle, social circle, etc., so that's such a marriage became you and your kufu. Right? Now this word is used for Allah Azza wa Jal. He says, وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا. And He never had any counterpart, anyone that can be compared to Him, anyone that could be toe-to-toe with Allah Azza wa Jal. This, all of this, what we're learning here is tafsir of one word. What word? Ahad. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَد. When we learn that word ahad, everything else that we're learning in this surah is a consequence of that word. Allahu Samad is a consequence. Lam yalid wa lam yulad is a consequence. Wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad is also a consequence. But in this, there's something else. Wa taqdimul aham ula. You see, in Arabic grammar, this is why grammar is it's a geeky subject to study, but the benefits of it, subhanallah. Wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad is actually not grammatically the expected sequence. Wa lam yakun ahadun kufuwan lahu. That is the grammatically expected sequence of the sentence. But Allah rearranged pieces of this sentence. Ahad is at the end, right? And then lahu is in the beginning, and kufu is in the middle. The original sequence was going to be, Allah was to be mentioned at the end. The one who was going to be counterparting him was going to be mentioned in the beginning. Ahad. Now, in this sentence, what's the most important entity? Lahu refers to Allah. Kufu, the counterpart. Ahad, anyone else. So which is the most valuable words? Lahu. And part of Arabic rhetoric, Al-Aham Ula. The most important should, Al-Awwal. The most important should come first. Allah mentions himself first before he mentions everything else. He says Ahad, one of the meanings of Ahad is Al-Awwal also. Not just Laysa Lahu Thani, Ahad means for the one for whom there is no second, but also the one that comes first. And even in the sentence, Allah mentions himself first. That's one benefit. The other benefit is Ikhtisas. It is he who never has a counterpart, meaning everyone other than him will always have a counterpart. You will have a general, there'll be another general. You'll have a king, there'll be another king. You'll have one false god, you'll have another false god. You'll have one rich person, you'll have another rich person. You'll have one planet, another planet, one star, another star. Everything that is in this in existence will have a kufu. But it is only he that will not. And where did I get that only he? Because lahu is earlier. وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ. Now just finally, inshallah ta'ala, I want to read to you some benefits of this surah that are commented on. I found the commentary of Al-Razi very beneficial in this, so I'm going to share at least some parts of it with you. He says, I want to mention the first one only. أَنَّ أَوَّلَ السُّورَ يَدُلُّ عَلَى أَنَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَاحِدٌ وَالصَّمَدْ عَلَى أَنَّهُ كَرِيمٌ رَحِيمٌ. He says, the first part of this surah, make sure we understand that Allah is unique and one. The second part, Allahu Samad, make sure we understand how gracious and merciful He is. Why is the grace of mercy embedded inside As-Samad? Because everybody turns to Him and He fulfills what they need. لأنه يصمد إليه يكون محسنا ولم يلد ولم يولد على أنه غني على الإطلاق. And the fact that he says he did not beget nor is he begotten, make sure we understand that he does not need anyone absolutely at all, and that he is free from all kinds of alterations in this or any kind of weakness, because having children is a type of weakness. Why is it weakness? Because I will die one day. How will my species continue? For an animal, how will the species continue? By children, by having offspring. For human beings, if you're not worried about the human species, you're at least still worried about your last name or your family, you know? And if you're not worried about it now, when you become 40 or 50, you say, I don't have any children. I have nothing to leave behind, right? This is the thing that the Arabs gave so much importance. And so there's a contrast. One of the things that was said about the messenger that was the most hurtful, Abtar, doesn't have any kids. Doesn't have sons. That can be an insult to the creation. And a compliment to the creation is you have children. And كَانَ لَهُ مَالٌ وَبَنِينَ. This is actually an attribute. Wow, he's got money and kids. He's doing well. This was a status symbol in Arab society. But the same thing that is an insult to the messenger, to say that he doesn't have a child or doesn't have a son, etc., etc., would be insulting to the messenger. But to say Allah has would be an insult to Allah Azza wa Jal. It's reversed, right? Because what is the honoring of Allah can never be compared to the honoring of creation. They're two very different standards. And so Allah makes sure we understand the different standards for these two different things, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, this surah, in conclusion, this surah is probably the most important surah for our children to internalize. Not just memorizing, I think all our kids know it, and all of you know it, but to internalize. What does it really mean? What does it really mean practically for me that Allah is Ahad, that He is As-Samad, that He has no beginning and no end? And we talked about the psychology of shirk that is crushed in لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ. And then وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا, no counterpart, no one can be compared to him. So you understand in times of need, in times of difficulty, when you recite وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ, you will remember. All my problems can come from somewhere, but you know Allah can solve them, and there's no one who can create problems when Allah solves them. This is the surah where we learn to completely give ourselves to Allah. completely give ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's a reason Sahaba loved this surah so much. There's a reason, it protects us from so many things. And the thing I tell you, one of the names of this surah, An-Najat. This is the surah of rescue. It rescues you from depression, from sadness. It rescues you from it. Because now, whenever something happens, you can take your problems to who? Allah. You can take your problems to the police station, you may or may not get an answer. You can take your problems to your physician, you may or may not get results. But there's one place you will get, you always go, you'll always get. You will always get. It removes your problems. And it's najat min al-nar for millions and millions and millions of people who end up doing the worst crime of shirk. This surah comes and protects even the least educated of the Muslims. If they can just learn this surah, they'll be protected from the fire. They'll be protected from that great, that heinous crime of shirk. May Allah protect us and our children from the crime of shirk. May Allah make us internalize the remarkable lessons of this surah. May Allah make us of those who understand the Qur'an, internalize it, remember Allah by means of the Qur'an, and practice it along with the sunnah of His beloved Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim, wa nafa'ni wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikri al-Hakim. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.